my heart is overwhelmed.
Oh, when my heart is overwhelmed. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. That is higher than I.
What a mighty God we serve.
Jesus is the God we serve. Jesus is the God we serve. The angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. Jesus is the God we serve.
We bring sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord.
We bring sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of praise.
Bring the sacrifice.
We bring sacrifice of praise into the house of the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of praise.
He is a miracle working God.
Miracle-working God. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is a miracle-working God.
Tell him.
He is a miracle-working God. He is a miracle-working God. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is a miracle-working God.
Yes, come on, tell him.
He is a miracle-working God. He is a miracle-working God. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is a miracle-working God.
Jesus is my deliverer.
Jesus is my deliverer. Jesus is my deliverer.
Come on.
Jesus is my deliverer. Jesus is my deliverer. Jesus is my deliverer. I know who delivers.
How do you know?
How do you know he delivers? How do you know he delivers? How do you know he delivers? I know he delivers.
How do you know?
How do you know?
To see the glory of the Lord,
why don't you praise him? Lift up your hands and praise him. If you want to see the glory of the Lord, why don't you lift up your hands and praise the Lord? Praise him in the morning, praise him in the noontime, praise him in the evening. up your hands and praise him.
Come on, lift your hands.
If you want to see the glory of the Lord, why don't you lift up your hands and praise the Lord? Praise him in the morning, praise him in the noontime, praise him in the evening. Praise him all the day long, lift up your hands and praise the Lord.
Lift Jesus higher, higher and higher. Lift him up for the world to see. Said if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men. Lift Jesus higher, higher and higher. Lift him up for the world to see. Said if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men on. Lift him, lift Jesus higher, higher and higher. Lift him up for the world to see. Said if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men.
Lift up your hands,
lift up your hands, lift up your hands, lift up your hands and praise the Lord. Praise him, my Lord, and the blessings will flow. Lift up your hands and praise the Lord. Lift up your hands, lift up your hands, lift up your hands and praise the Lord. Praise him, my Lord, and the blessings will. Lift up your hands and praise the Lord.
Lift up your hands,
lift up your hands, lift up your hands and praise the Lord. Praise him, my Lord, and the blessings will flow. Lift up your hands and praise the Lord.
Come on, lift your hands and praise him. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord. We adore you. We bless you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We bless you, Lord. We magnify your name. You're wonderful today, Lord. We just praise you. Hallelujah. We want to see the warriors in the house. If you are warriors, let me see you put your hands up. But we are no warrior. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I am a warrior. I am a conqueror, an overcomer, oh, 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 in the name of the Lord. I am a warrior, I am a conqueror, an overcomer, oh, 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 in the name of the Lord.
We are going up. I'm a warrior.
I am a warrior. I am a conqueror. I'm an overcomer. Oh, oh, oh. In the name of the Lord.
I am a warrior.
I am a warrior. I am a conqueror. I'm an overcomer. Oh, oh.
Now
stop, don't talk, no, no, don't speak defeat to me. I am a child of God, and I got the victory.
Stop, don't talk, now
stop, don't talk, no, no, don't speak defeat to me. I am a child of God, and I got the victory.
What are you today? You are a warrior.
I am a warrior. I am a conqueror. I'm an overcomer. Oh, oh, oh.
give him praise. Give him praise today. Hallelujah. The Lord has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of love, power, and of a sound mind today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We have been given all the tools to make war against the enemy this evening. Amen. And we know that we serve a mighty and miraculous God this evening. Hallelujah. There is nothing too difficult for him to do this evening. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you have sickness in your bodies, he can heal you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There is nothing that he can do. No matter what situation and problem they come your way, he is able to deliver this evening. Amen. Hallelujah. So, Father, we praise you. We glorify your name, Lord. We bless and lift you up, my God. Hallelujah. We thank you for your goodness and your love and your mercy. We thank you for your grace today, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. We bless you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. Come on, tell him, I worship you. I worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is what I long to do. I give you praise, for you are my righteousness. I worship you. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. Come on, tell them I worship you. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. I worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is what I long to do. I give you praise, for you are my righteousness. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. And let me hear you say it, I worship you.
I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you.
Come on, tell him.
I worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is what I want you to do. I give you praise, for you are my righteousness.
There is none.
There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. And I can search for all eternity long and find there is none like you.
Tell him there is none. Jesus.
No one else can touch my heart like you do. And I can search for all eternity long and find there is none like you.
Are we going to sing in a dearest?
Hallelujah.
We know that His presence is in this place this evening. Hallelujah. Father, we bless you. We worship you. We glorify your name, oh God. We thank you for your presence in this place, oh God. Father, we want to say that you are awesome this evening, oh my God. And there is none like you, oh God. We will continue to bless and to praise you. We will continue to worship you. Oh, Father, in the good and the bad times, oh God, we will glorify your name, oh God, because we know, oh God, that you are mighty and you are awesome. We know that you are worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. Jesus. Hallelujah.
You are beautiful beyond description.
Come on, tell him.
Too marvelous for words, too wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard.
And I stand my God.
Every challenge we face tonight. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to share your word, and I thank you for your people who have heard to hear tonight, Lord, that they will hear what the Spirit is saying to us as we prepare ourselves for the great expectation we have.
Yes.
Lord, we live for that moment. We look forward to that moment, as we see the world getting darker and darker, we are preparing ourselves to meet your expectation and all your requirements so the church can be in a state of readiness for any eventuality. Come what may, we are more than conquerors through him that loves us, gave his life for us. Help us tonight. Educate us, inspire us, and Lord, help us to understand your word, your wisdom, your knowledge. Get the knowledge of you, Lord, and to know your will, your ways, to walk pleasing to you, and to do your will and your work. In Jesus' name, all the people of God said, amen and amen. Bless the Lord. The Lord bless you real good. You can have your seats tonight, and I want to take this opportunity to welcome you into the presence of the Lord, and the Lord will not disappoint you this very moment. We thank God for his moment of grace. Amen. Appreciate your presence here, and I know the Lord will not disappoint you. Hallelujah. All right. Are you ready for the word? Without any further delay, I want to go straight into the Bible and bring to you God's unadulterated word. Praise the Lord. Amen. Are you ready? If you're ready, say amen. All right, here we go. Straight to the rock. Hallelujah. You got your Bibles? Praise the Lord. Help us tonight, Lord. All right, I want to speak to you in a very timely subject. It is what God expects of us, and it has to do with godly behavior and good behavior and godly living. How many of you know we have to maintain that attitude in expectation of the coming of the Lord? He has to meet us, behaving ourselves and living a godly life. Are you there? All right. So I want to take you to the scriptures, and I want to admonish you tonight. All right? I'm not going to do too much introduction. We're going to get straight into the teaching tonight. Okay? Now, how do we conduct ourselves as Christians in this ungodly world? The world is so corrupt and so ungodly. In fact, when I say godly, I mean it is so godless. They have they're not retaining the thought of God in their mind. They're taking God off their mind. This is why they're doing what they're doing. So the world is really messy. Can you see that? The world is really messy. But God has given us what it takes to clean up our lives. And in spite of a messy world, we can live and practice good behavior and godly living. Amen. Because God has given us what it takes to do that. Amen. So when we talk about good behavior and godly living, we are talking about our attitude, how we conduct ourselves, how we behave ourselves in this ungodly world. But let me remind you tonight that your attitude communicates clearer than words. Your attitude communicates clearer than words. And we have choices every day. And for the past couple of weeks, I've been talking about desires and choices. You know, every day we make choices. And to have a good attitude, to have good behavior and godly living, is a choice. It's a choice that we make each day, all right? You know, some people plan for victory. Some people plan for misery. You know, I heard a story once, and this is a true story, of a waitress. A friendly waitress couldn't get a smile out of a certain customer. And the woman was dull and depressed and dejected all through the time she sat there having her dinner. And the food was delicious and the food was good. And as the woman paid her bill and was leaving, the waitress wanted to ask her a question. So the waitress got her attention and said, ask her, he said, you know, ma'am, have a nice day. That's all she said, have a nice day. Guess what the woman said to her? Kind of, you know, snappishly. She said, I am sorry, but I've made other plans. So some people, they plan for misery. Somebody tells you have a nice day and you say, I'm sorry, I have other plans. You are planning for misery. Because who would want to refuse a nice day? So we have to understand attitude communicates clearer than anything. Because she sat there with an attitude. You know, sometimes people sit with an attitude. You meet somebody with an attitude. You can tell something is wrong with them. That's all. You know, I like what Charles Swindoll said. He said, the longer I live, the more I realize the impact of attitude on life. Attitude to me is more important than facts, more important than the past, than education, than money, than circumstances, than failures, than success, than what other people think or say or do. It is more important than appearance, talent, or skills. It will make or break a company, a church, an individual, or home. The remarkable thing is we have a choice every day regarding the attitude we will embrace. We cannot change our past, cannot change the fact that people will act in a certain way, and cannot change the inevitable. The only thing we can do is play on the one string that we have, and that is our attitude. He went on to say, I'm convinced that life is 10% what happens to me and 90% how I react to it. And so it is with you. Very powerful. So tonight, I want you to know we are in charge of our attitude. We are in charge of our attitude. And we're living in a ungodly world. And God tells us how we can live godly in an ungodly world. In Titus chapter 2, it says in verse 11 and 12, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation, and the word bringeth there means brings. I mean, it's still bringing. The grace of God that bringeth or brings salvation hath appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we shall what? Live soberly, righteously, and godly. Where? In this present world. Now, I'm going to run some scriptures quickly to lay a foundation. You run to Psalm chapter 4, verse 2. But know that the Lord hath set apart him that is godly for himself. The Lord will hear when I call unto him. You go to 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 18, and it says, If the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? So we are differentiating there now. We are seeing the godly, the ungodly. We live in an ungodly world, and God is admonishing us. What is the impact of ungodliness and what we can be? Okay, and as the righteous, we are warned. If the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? All right, 1 Peter 4:18. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5, here it is again. What God did, he said, he spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly. So the Bible makes it clear what God will do, what he has done, and what he will do with the ungodly. You go to Jude chapter 1, verse 15, we are told again, the day is coming when God will execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their what? Ungodly deeds, which they have ungodly committed, and of all their hard speeches, which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. There's a warning again. You go to Proverbs chapter 16, verse 27. An ungodly man diggeth up evil. In his lips there is a burning what? Fire. In his lips there is a burning fire. Psalm 1:5. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. But here is the promise for the righteous. He said, blessed is the man that walketh not, Psalm 1:1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. So there you have it. God is saying to us what he expects of us, good behavior and godly living in a godless world. All right? So we are in charge of our attitudes. We are definitely in charge of our attitudes. So what does God expect of my behavior? What kind of a attitude am I embracing? All right? Now, we have a choice every day regarding the attitude we will embrace. Okay? We have a choice how you want to deport or conduct yourself when you wake up in the morning, what kind of person you want to be. All right? Psalm 101, verse 2. Look what David said. This is the attitude of the psalmist. He said, I will behave myself wisely in a perfect way. That's a choice to embrace a certain attitude. I will behave myself wisely in a perfect way. Oh, when wilt thou come unto me? I will walk within my house with a perfect heart. A perfect heart. Perfect attitude. Are you with me? Paul, in his letter to Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 3:15, look what he says. If I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God. Notice what he said. How you ought to behave yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of truth. Okay, so Paul was encouraging Timothy how to behave himself in the church. Behave yourself in the church, which is the what? The house of God. Amen. The house of the living God, the pillar and the ground of truth. So, in essence, our behavior is an eloquent testimony to who we are and what we think, wherever we are. You getting me? Your behavior is a testimony to who you are and what you are, what you think, wherever you are. Holy thoughts or corrupt behavior cannot coexist. You cannot have holy thoughts and corrupt behavior. I think it's impossible. Because if we try to pretend, then that's hypocrisy. God knows the heart of the hypocrites. So you can fool me, but you cannot fool him. So it is a lie to have holy thoughts and corrupt behavior. All right? Because they just cannot coexist. So it's a lie to say we follow Christ if we are disregarding his word and ignoring his commands or his truth. All of us know how surprising and disappointing it is when we hear people give clear Christian testimonies and yet we see they have questionable lifestyle. They say all kind of nice things about the Christian life, but when you look at them and how they live and how the attitude and the behavior, the communication, it's totally different than what they say. Again, we could only fool ourselves and people, but we cannot fool God. So if we want to be a church without spot or wrinkle, a glorious church, we better check our behavior. Amen? And our attitude. So I'm telling you, God will use me to prepare you for the coming of Jesus. To find you without spot or wrinkle, the choice will be yours. I'm going to feed you from the word. Okay? Now the Spirit of God calls us to what? Holy living, which is a godly life. Holy living is a godly life. Hallelujah. A life that is full of God, God's presence. We have to make every effort to live according to what? His guidelines and his principles, his word, his wisdom, his will, his ways, his work. Amen. The work of the godly, the work of the wise, the work of wisdom, the work of his will. He gives us guidelines. Why? There are at least four reasons. Number one, first, if we are truly new creation in Christ, and I believe we are born again, right? Any man in Christ. If we are truly new creation in Christ, then God's Holy Spirit is living within us, helping us want to do what is right. How many of you believe there is a passion in you? You know there's a passion. You want to do what is right. Paul talks about that. He said, I want to do what is right, but there's another battle going on in me. When I want to do right, I always find myself doing wrong. The things I don't want to do, I find myself doing it. But I thank God through Jesus Christ, I'm delivered. So once you're a new creature, 2 Corinthians 5:17 tells us, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. All things are what? Passed away, and behold, all things have become new. So what we learn there is this, okay? We are new creation in Christ, okay? We are new creation in Christ. The Holy Spirit is living in us. If the Holy Spirit is living in us, listen to me. He will convict you of sin. He will convict you of righteousness, and he will convict you of judgment. And once you receive that conviction, you're in Christ, it means you're walking in the Spirit, he will convict you. It is up to you to make a conscious decision to obey the Holy Spirit, because he has given you the guidelines. Thank God we are guided by the Spirit. He will lead you or guide you into what? All truths. Amen. So that's number one. Number two, godly living is an example to unbelieving people, unbelieving friends, your neighbors, co-workers, who may notice that we are different. When you live godly, you don't have to tell people you're a Christian. They will observe it. They will notice it by your language, your deportment, your conduct, even the way you dress. They will know you're a Christian. There is decency. Because you see, godliness is not the outward appearance. It starts from inside. Once you have a godly mindset, once you have the Holy Spirit living inside of you, you purposely will not do anything to misrepresent him or to embarrass him or to embarrass the name of Jesus. Amen? We are called by his name. So I want you to take note of that. Godly living is an example to unbelievers, unbelieving friends, neighbors, co-workers, who may notice that we are different. See, people are attracted to others who are constantly kind, gracious, loving, compassionate, caring. They must see, I believe, people will be attracted to the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit, the Bible calls it fruit, not fruits. The fruit of the Spirit is love. They'll be attracted to that. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. They'll be attracted to these things when you live it. Now remember, you're living out the fruit of the Spirit because the Holy Spirit is in you. You're a new creation in Christ. And thirdly, godly living is a confirmation that we are, in fact, living for God and not for ourselves. It is the barometer of our relationship with God. It boils down to the relationship with God. And fourthly, godly living means that we are emulating Christ, who is our ultimate example of how to live. If you want to know how to live, follow Jesus. You want to know how to speak? Follow Jesus. You want to know what attitude to have? Follow Jesus. Amen. So what does God expect of my behavior? Well, God wants each of us to be an example of Christ to others. What better example can we be? Be an example of Christ. Be an example of Christ to others. How he forgives, how he loves, how he treated people. how he treated those who loved God, how he treated those who rejected God. Everything about Jesus we can learn and we can apply. The life that Jesus lived, he made it so simple that even a child can follow him. Anybody can follow Jesus, because following Jesus is not hard. It's not hard. You know why? It is hard if you want to do your will and his will at the same time. But if you surrender your will to the Lord and deny yourself, that's when it becomes easy. And that's what Paul meant when he said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Because it's not my will, but thy will be done. And Jesus also told us how to pray like that. Amen? So you're living as a new creature in Christ. And what he's saying, the life I now live, it is not I that live it, but who? Christ that liveth in me. Amen? Because I am crucified with Christ. Hallelujah. So when you go to 1 Timothy 4 and 12, it says, let no man despise thy youth. Be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. So you notice here, Paul again giving Timothy, young Timothy, preparing him for ministry, preparing him for pastoral ministry and for, you know, and using him as an example that all of us can learn from him and the teaching that he gave to Timothy. It's not just for Timothy alone, it's for all of us. All right? So he said, no, for you young people, he said, let no man despise thy youth. There's so much in you that God wants to pull out. Amen? God, he knows what he placed in you. He knows what you're capable of doing, the capacity you have, the ability you have. He knows that. He will never demand something from you that he didn't put in you. So he created you with a bunch of stuff. So he said, let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers. This is something we ought to practice, all of us. And we do it in words, conversation, charity, which is love, in spirit, in faith, in purity. So our attitude, again, must be godly. Godly attitude. Amen? So Paul instructs young Timothy here, young disciples, to focus on five areas modeling the person of Jesus Christ. Okay? Five areas. Let me give you them. Number one, in speech, we model a true disciple in speech. Watch what it says. We must guard not only the teaching we receive, but also our words to others and our words about others. Let me say it again. How many of you thank God that you have speech? The gift of speech. You can talk. There are people who cannot speak. You have the gift of communication through words. You can talk. You're not dumb. Amen. Thank God for that. Well, God is saying, whatever you're receiving here tonight, as Paul declared to Timothy, whatever you're receiving here tonight, the teaching you receive, he said, guard it. Okay? Guard what you're hearing. And now when you are speaking to others, guard your words, not only when you're speaking to them, but when you're speaking about them. You know what that will do? Eliminate confusion. Eliminate bad mouthing. Eliminate gossiping. You will never have anything negative to say about you because you're watching what you're saying to people and what you're saying about people. Am I making myself clear? So between members, you know, if you know something, we have knowledge of somebody's weakness or faults, be careful what you say about that person to somebody else. It is none of your business to communicate people's weakness to other people. If you notice something and you feel convicted and the Holy Spirit shows you something, I think the first thing the Holy Spirit asks you to do is intercede. Amen? So watch your speech. Paul instructs his disciples, his young disciples, to focus on these areas. What? Number one, speech. Number two, behavior. Our lived out faith should cause us to acknowledge God in everything we do. We are living out our faith. That's what James said. Faith without what? Works is dead. So we live out our faith every day as Christian children of God, as believers. We live out our faith. We don't live a Christian life only on a Sunday. Come on, every day we live. While you're driving in the traffic, coming to church or going from church, you live out your Christian life. Your attitude must always be Christian. Your behavior, live out your faith. Amen? Because you acknowledge God. Acknowledge God while you're driving. Acknowledge God when you're talking. Acknowledge God when you're communicating. Acknowledge God before you go to bed. Acknowledge God when you wake up. Acknowledge God when somebody says something bad about you. Acknowledge God before you say something bad about somebody. Always acknowledge God. In all thy ways, acknowledge. There you have it. Are we doing it? Are we doing it? In all thy ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct. Say, okay, Lord, I'm going to work today. Give me direction. Lord, I have to do this business today. Give me favor. Acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. Amen. Behavior. Number three, he spoke to his disciples about love. Speech, behavior, love. It's easier for others to follow example if they know we love them. Hallelujah. People will follow example, follow your example, follow my example, if they know we what? Love them. Why do we follow Jesus? Because he first loves us. Amen? And number four, faith. Others should see that we are very confident. We are confident. Others should know that we are confident. And we have confidence in God. We are confident in what we're doing, and we have confidence in God. And that confidence in God motivates us, motivates our efforts, motivates our speech, our behavior, our love. They must see our confidence motivating our speech, our confidence in God motivating our speech, our confidence in God motivating our behavior, our confidence in God motivating our love. Everything we do, they must see that we have confidence in God. That is showing them that we live by faith. We put our faith in God because we have confidence in God. When we speak, when we love, in our behavior, we have confidence in God. Hello? Are you receiving this? And number five, purity. Now, these five things Paul was, getting his disciples to focus on. Speech, behavior, love, faith, purity. When he talks about purity, our lives should be characterized by transparency. How many know? Can you say this about, I have nothing to hide? Our lives should be characterized by transparency, integrity, honesty, even about our mistakes and failures. If I make a mistake, it ought to be a genuine mistake. Why? Because I do not want to presumptuously sin against God. Hello? So that's where transparency comes in. That's why even my mistakes or failures must be quick to acknowledge, yes, well, I made a mistake. Was it presumptuous? No. Hello? So God wants us to live in purity. And when we talk about that again, I want to make sure you understand it. Our lives should be what? Characterized by what? Transparency and integrity and honesty, even about our mistakes and failures. So don't let anyone think less of you. Don't let anyone despise you, whether you're young, whether you're old. Timothy was young, so Paul said, don't let no one despise your youth. If he was older, he would have said, don't let no man despise your age. So I'm saying to all of you, like Paul, don't let nobody despise you, totally. Be an example to all believers in what you say and in the way you live, the way you love, the way you have faith, and the way you live a pure life. Be a good example. Also, you must not only do all of these things, these five things, but relying on our own wisdom and efforts will cause us to fall prey to the world's influence. So we do not stick to our own understanding, our own wisdom. If we lean on our own wisdom, we really don't know anything. And if you think you know something, may I remind you tonight, somebody knows more than you. So relying on our own ideology, philosophy, own wisdom, and effort will cause us to fall prey to the world's influence, because that's how the world operates, the ungodly world we're talking about. Because when you go to Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, we can see that in various lights, you know. He says, and be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So allow, what is saying here? Allow God's Spirit to literally transform your behavior. You see, I don't know about you, but in a relationship with God, especially if you have a prayer life, you talk to God and let him know your heart's desires. Say, Lord, I need transformation in my thinking, in my thoughts, in my behavior. Don't be afraid to tell God where your weaknesses are and what you want him to strengthen. God is Spirit. Talk to him. Allow God's Spirit to literally transform him. Say, Lord, don't work in me right now while I'm praying and worshiping you. And he will help you live by a higher standard than those who, you know, who are unsaved. Come on. The world's standard, the world has a standard, and the church has a standard. But the church standard is a higher standard. And the Holy Spirit is one who will help us to live this higher standard than those unsaved there. Now, you cannot be a Christian and a man who is not a Christian conducting himself better than you are on the job. I know a lot of you are under conviction right now. And the same goes in the neighborhood. You can't be living in the village, and there are people in the village who is living a better life than you are, as far as attitude and behavior and conduct and godliness. The only thing you can, they're not a Christian, but the way they live is put some Christians to shame. You can't be a Christian and going to Tom, Dick, and Harry and this one and talking other Christian bad. When you talk, say bad things about other Christians, they are looking at you and your attitude, you know. And I say, what kind of person are you? I mean, they will be telling you, what kind of person is this? And they look at you. You come to me with somebody's problem and somebody that you're not minding your own business and trying to tell me something about somebody's life to condemn them, bring them down. I look at you as somebody I cannot trust. You see? Very serious. So when you, the Bible says love covereth a multitude of sins. That has a big, big meaning, and that's a have some depth in it. We take that lightly. That love there is the love of God. That is the love that God expressed while you were sin. You were the worst sinners in the world. For God so loved the wicked, ugly, sinful world that he gave his life. That's the love. That love caused God to take his blood and cover it. And cover everybody who desired to come under the blood. You know, he died to save the whole world, but the whole world just rejected it. But he died to save every sinner if they'll come under the blood. It's a choice. If rain is falling out there and you're going to get wet, and there's a shed, I put a nice shed here for you. And I said, the rain is going to wet you, you're going to get sick, and you'll die. Come under the shed and you'll be dry. And it's your choice. That's what God did. If you stay out there, you'll die in your sin. But if you come under the blood, you're going to be saved. It's a choice. So God allows the Spirit to literally transform our minds, our way of thinking. He brings us to a place where we live a higher standard than the world standard. And we need to know that God's will isn't always easy, convenient, or pain-free. As a matter of fact, it could be the opposite. Yea, all that live godly in Christ shall suffer persecution. But because we don't want to suffer, we choose to do ungodly things. To alleviate because we don't really know we are Christians. We don't want anybody to know this and that about us. So we can get away with certain things. So if I do this, I don't want them to know I'm a Christian. I'm going to do this. So if I go down licensing office with all that long line there, I could do something. I don't want anybody to know I'm a Christian today. So let me do something. If they know I'm a Christian, I won't do that. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah, what you did before, you know? So we need to understand doing the right thing is not always easy. It's not always easy, but it will bring you to a higher standard. When you refuse somebody who wants you to do something, listen, when you refuse that person look up to you, you know? You see? When somebody says, well, you know, you can do this, you can do that. I say, no, I'm not going down that road at all. You see me? I respect the presence of the Holy Spirit in my life. Let them know what you stand for. They will respect you. They'll never forget that. We must keep reminding ourselves that it is good and pleasing and perfect when we do God's will, even though it's not easy, it's not convenient, and it's not pain-free. Yes, we're going to face some opposition, some accusation, some condemnation. We're going to face all kind of stuff. But it's okay. It's okay as long as God is pleased. As long as God pleased. So ask yourself frequently, how is following Jesus changing my way of life, the way I think about everything? How is following Jesus changing my life every day? And don't copy the behavior and customs of the world. This is why I said, do not be conformed to the world. Do not copy the behavior of the world. Do not copy the customs of the world. We don't have to do things the world's way. Amen? The world have a bazaar, or they have some kind of fete out there. They have music, thumping music, like, I mean, it could shake your heart out of your body. We don't have to have music like that in our vehicle or in our church function. We must not sound like the world or be like the world. The Bible says be transformed. Do not be conformed to the way the world do things. Our music must be decent, where the Holy Spirit can enjoy. And the Holy Spirit is not going to sit in your vehicle with a thumping music. You'll drive him away. Because in quietness and confidence, Isaiah says, is my strength. The Holy Spirit is not noise and blah, 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 blah. There's something. There's a time to rejoice. There's a time to praise and everything. But everything must be done within God's standard. Everybody understand that? And that's what it says. So God's way is not always easy and convenient. So ask yourself, how is following Jesus changing the way I think about everything? And don't copy the behavior and customs of the world, please. Allow the Holy Spirit of God, the one who will quicken you when the trumpet sound. Allow him to transform you by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will, which is good, acceptable, and perfect. All that came from chapter 12, verse 2. So God expects Christians to live by a higher standard reflecting his character. That's what we do. We reflect the character of God. Setting an example of behavior for others to what? Follow. When you go to verse 13, in chapter 13, the same book, Romans chapter 13, what it says? Let us walk how honestly as in the day, meaning in light. Not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying. Why? Because we belong to the day. What that means? We are children of the light. Because we belong to the day, we must live decent lives for all to see. And we must never participate in the darkness of godless parties and godless gatherings and godless weddings and godless functions. where people together eating and drinking and marrying and drunkenness and all these things. We must never participate in the darkness of godless parties and gatherings. I would not want the Lord to come and meet you in some godly gathering, enjoying what they're enjoying. Don't let it happen. That's the peculiarity of being a Christian in this day and age. We cannot risk our salvation. I see, and I've known in the past, people will put off church service on a Sunday morning to go to some Hindu wedding. God help you. It could be my grandmother. My mother married and again. I ain't going. I go to church. Are you listening to me? I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. That's why following Jesus is not convenient to a lot of people. It's hard to some people because you have two wills fighting in your mind. But you see, you got to surrender your will. I said, not my will, but thy will be done. Acknowledge God. If you acknowledge God, you know what the Holy Spirit tells you? Go into the house of God like David. I was glad when they said to me, let's go to the house of the Lord. This one thing I desire, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord, that I may inquire of his beauty. Listen to me, people. Don't compromise your standard with the world. Amen? So let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting or drunkenness, not in chambering or wantonness, not in strife and envying, because we belong to the day. We must live decent lives for all to see. We must never participate in darkness, in the darkness of godless parties, godless gathering, with drunkenness, or get involved in sexual promiscuity and immoral living, or even quarreling and jealousy. All that is right there in that verse. See? I'm rightly dividing it to you. Drunkenness, gambling, wantonness, strife, envy. No. This thing must not be named among them. We must not be identified with that. You know, when you live a Christian life to the point where somebody says, they will not ask you certain questions, and they will not invite you to certain things because they know what you stand for. That's the kind of life you want to live. When your family could say, no, don't think about inviting him. He would not come. That's when you know you drew the line. Because we are no longer attempting to earn or to deserve God's love. We are free to please him with our obedience. Amen? We are free to please him with our obedience. The impossibility of perfection once haunted us, but now genuine progress is reason to celebrate. Because we are no longer tempted to earn or deserve God's glory. We are freed to please him with our obedience. So how do my behavior affect others? Oh my goodness. How does God expect me to behave, and how does my behavior affect others? Well, you want me to tell you? The selfishness of poor behavior often hurts the people we love most. What? The selfishness of poor behavior often hurts the people we love most. And you'll find it in 1 Samuel chapter 20, verse 34. What I'm saying to you, my friend, is in the Bible. Look what it says. Remember Jonathan and David, right? Watch this. Look at a little family feud here. Watch this. Watch how Jonathan handled himself. You want to know? I'm going to say it again. The selfishness of poor behavior often hurts the people we love. And look at a perfect example here in 1 Samuel chapter 20. Verse 34 says, so Jonathan arose from the table in fierce anger and did eat no meat the second day of the month. Why? For he was grieved for David. Why was he grieving for David? Because his father had done him shame. His own father has done something to his best friend that made Jonathan feel ashamed. And he said, I will not eat. And he got up from the table. He was grieved. He was angry, fierce anger. This is a powerful story of showing how selfish and poor behavior hurts the people we love. And that behavior of Saul hurt Jonathan, who loved his friend David. Watch this. This story of Jonathan reminds us of the complication created by the negative ways we respond to others. Jonathan was caught between a father he honored and served, that's King Saul, and a friend he deeply admired, who was David. And he was caught between both of them. The fact that David consistently honored Saul as king made it even harder for Jonathan to accept his father's treachery towards David. So here, David is treating my father really good. And this is what my father is doing to David. Jonathan didn't like that. Don't get him wrong. So it speaks volume about Jonathan that he never betrayed either his father or his friends as he navigated the enmity between them. So here, like a mediator, he loved David, and then his kin to his father, he loved both of them. And how he navigated himself is what we learn. He sailed with a remarkable loyalty in treacherous waters, and that's what we need to do. We need to know how to navigate ourselves when people with poor behavior, whom we love in the church, hurts people we love also in the church. So I love you, and I love you, and you hurting you, you hurting you, and you hurting you. And I love both of you. Who's going to be my enemy there? Which side am I going to take? You come like the Lord. Let me tell you something. God is not a sports fan. How many of you watch football these days? God is not a sports fan. And God don't have sides. Because you're playing for England and you're playing for Japan. And you're Christian and you're Christian. You're praying and I'm God. And you're praying on your knees, oh Lord, help me win and score a goal. And you're praying, Lord, help me win and score a goal. Who's side of it? So God, don't play games. I said, God, don't play games. There's something God don't get involved in. I see sports, that is an idol right now. I see big men crying like fools. Stupid, stupid, stupid. If you cry out to God for their soul, they're going to win that cup and still go to hell without Jesus. So Jonathan, watch this. Jonathan left the table in shock because he was crushed by his father's shameful behavior towards David. And that's what happens sometimes among us. We are crushed when we realize how some Christian really behave against some Christians or other Christians. I don't want to get you soured, okay? But is it the truth? Aren't you shocked sometimes when people behave? I'm telling you, I know what I'm talking about. See, our behavior never happens in a vacuum or without context. When others affect us, we internalize their treatment for better or for worse. And then we in turn affect others. And we see the process acted out over decades in Joseph's life and Joseph's relationship with his brothers, not so? The same thing. And we notice in Genesis chapter 50, we notice the lessons he learned along the way. In chapter 50, verse 18, talking of Joseph, he said, and his brother, now it's similar to what happened to Saul and Jonathan and David. See, family, and you know, friendship, was it? And his brethren also went and fell down before his face, that's his brothers, and they said, behold, we be thy servant. No, let us be thy servant. And Joseph said unto them, fear not, for am I in the place of God? You bowing to me? I'm the one, am I God to judge you? But as for you, you thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good. See, he knew how to navigate the process. He said, but you meant it for good. God meant it for good. To bring to pass, as it is this day, to save much people alive. Now, therefore, fear ye not. I will nourish you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spake kindly unto them. That's the kind of attitude we need to have. The godliness and the godly behavior to navigate between people who are very, very hard to deal with. Some ungodly behavior. And his ungodly behavior of his brothers. But he had the Spirit of God in him. Hallelujah. And no matter how people behave, this is why the Bible says the righteous scarcely be saved. Where shall the sinner and the ungodly appear? So we have to understand, we have this battle going on between Christians. And you are not being a Christian, or you're trying to walk in the Spirit and please the Lord, and you cannot take sides for this one or this one. You have to navigate, man, the process like you set your sail to go through troubled waters because you want to land safely in that peaceful harbor. So, beloved, I'm saying to you tonight, attitude, your behavior, these things are important. Watch this. We don't know how long it took for Joseph to move beyond the hurt of being betrayed by his own brothers. We don't know how long it took. Remember, the man was hurt, you know. But he never dwelt on his feelings and emotions. He always kept his mind on what God promised him. And he kept the vision in the pit. He kept the vision in the prison. He kept the vision at Potiphar's house. He had the vision, and the word tried him. And he kept his mind focused on the vision and did not allow the hurt to dominate him, because he understood God's purpose for him going through the process to get him to the throne. And we are going through a process progressively to get to the point and the place that God would have us to be. And it is not going to be an easy road, an easy task. We're going to face some challenging waters. And we have to learn to navigate this life. And the best thing is the wisdom of the Word of God. But we cannot use the Word of God without the Holy Spirit. Amen? And so we see Joseph, we don't know how long he was hurting and was hurt by his brothers. But you know what? Joseph moved beyond his hurt and the betrayal of his brothers to a place where he could see God working in everything that happened in his life. My God, listen to me. When I look back at my life, everything, whether good or bad, you look back at it and you do an assessment and say, Lord, I thank you that all things are working together for good, because you know I love you. And whatever you're going through right now, be it good or bad, down the road, you'll be able to look back and say, it's working. It's working now for my good. I'm receiving the good out of it. So you will go through the birth pang, but when the birth comes, when the baby comes, glory to God, you're rejoicing. It's worth the pain, man. The joy, there's nothing to be compared. Whatever you're going through now is not to be compared with what you shall receive. God will work the good for you. So we see that he understood that God is working and something was happening in his life, and you can clearly see the healing results. One, where you have been the cause of the others, cause of others' pain, you can see where you can be the cause of others' pain, and you must be willing to ask for forgiveness, because we saw that in this whole story there. They were the cause of his pain, and they asked for forgiveness. So when you cause pain in somebody's life, please learn to ask for forgiveness. I've been there, done that many times. And sometimes with the same person, more and more and over and over. But how many times? 70 times 7, you have to go. So we have still a lot to go yet. So one, where you are being the cause of others' pain, you must be willing to ask for forgiveness. We learn that from Joseph's story there and his brothers. And secondly, where others have hurt you, we must be ready to forgive and willing to see ways God could bring good out of the painful events as he did for Joseph. So they hurt Joseph, and Joseph was hurt. They asked for forgiveness, and Joseph was willing to forgive because he saw God in it. And that's how we operate. That's good attitude. That's good behavior. So his brothers came and threw themselves down before Joseph and said, look, we are your slave now. We are your slave. But Joseph replied, he said, don't be afraid of me. Am I God that I can punish you? He didn't punish them. He blessed them. You intended to hurt me, but God intended it all for good. And Joseph, the Bible says, reassured them by speaking kindly to them. If we could behave like that when people do us wrong or when we do people wrong, I tell you, we will be ready for the rapture, man. Amen? You know what Jesus said? Jesus said, I'm closing. Jesus said, the way we treat one another would be a powerful proof that you are following him. When he said that in John chapter 13, verse 34. He said, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. See, Jesus made it abundantly clear. So loving one another, what? Demonstrates whether our lives are changed and we are following Jesus. Loving one another. So let me tell you something. You can't be going to church and have hate in your heart for your brother or sister. You can't be following Jesus and have that. Amen? We never know just how many people are watching us as we seek to live for Christ. We just don't know. And the Bible says, by this men shall see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven by this love. So why is godly behavior so important? Whether we realize it or not, others will be affected by our behavior as we follow Jesus. They'll be affected, either negatively or positively. If you say you're following Jesus and we do bad things, it'll affect them negatively. If you say you're following Jesus and we do good things, it'll affect them positively. Are you getting me? Matthew 5, 14. You're the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Verse 15, neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all men that are in the house. And sometimes we read and we miss these words. He give light to all men that are in the house. Okay, if we turn that light switch off, everybody in darkness, right? If I turn the light switch on, everybody is in the light. So if you are shining the light wherever you are, all men in your presence will see the light. So he said, let your light shine. Amen? So, and notice what he said. But you put it on a candle, it giveth light unto all that are in the house. And then he said, let. You know what the word let mean? Permit. You have to permit it. Permit your light to shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. So remember, we must never shine for people to be impressed and praise us. We shine for people to be influenced to praise God. Influenced to what? Praise God. Amen? Like Brother Joseph was singing a while ago. He's singing so that people will be influenced to what? Praise God. Whatever we do is to influence people to what? Focus on God, not on us. God wants people to see what he can do in us so that they might begin to consider what he can do in them. You get that? That's powerful. I said God wants people to see what he can do in us so that they, you know, when we do that, they might begin to consider what he could do in them if they would allow him. So much of the Christian life is replacement work, okay? Are you with me? I almost finished. Can I finish it? Or bring it back next week again? Can you give me 5 minutes again? Much of the Christian life is replacement work. Eliminating negative behaviors, negative attitudes and conduct. You eliminate those things and replace it. By replacing them with ones that match God's character. So Ephesians 4:31-32, he said, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be ye kind one to another. So you see, you eliminate, you replace things, you remove and replace, and be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. So you see, you remove bitterness, remove wrath, remove anger, remove clamor, remove evil speaking, put it away, and put away malice, and you replace it with what? Kindness, tenderheartedness, forgiving one another, as God for Christ's sake has forgiven you. So what we are talking about, the Christian life, is what? A replacement work. Almost all the negative and the positive traits mentioned in these verses are relational. You realize that? It has to be relationship, not private. We express them towards others. Bitterness towards others, wrath towards others, anger towards others, clamor, evil speaking is towards others, kindness towards others, tenderheartedness, forgiving is towards others. For whose sake? Christ's sake. So we express them towards others. We are called to take seriously both what God tells us not to do and what he instructs us to do. So Paul concludes this thought by reminding us that the way we forgive others or not reveals how well we truly understand God's forgiveness. The way you forgive people will tell whether you really understand how much God forgive you. And we think that we can't forgive others, we should remind ourselves how much God has forgiven us. I have to say, I could never forgive. Well, just think about what God did for you. Amen? We are taught and instructed by God to turn from godless living and sinful pleasures. All right? This Bible is loaded with instructions. So we have no excuse. All right? We just need to read it. Titus 2 tells us, teaching us, in verse 12, the word of God, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live how? Soberly, righteously, godly in this present world. We should live in this evil world. With wisdom, righteousness, and devotion to God. Hallelujah. When we see godly behavior, when people see godly behavior in us, they will want to know what makes the difference in our lives. We will then have a wonderful opportunity to tell them. And then the preaching of the gospel becomes easy. Hallelujah. So if we claim to be God's children, we should behave like God's children, right? Romans 8:15 tells us, for you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption whereby we cry, Abba, Father, because we are his children. Our lifestyle clearly display our loyalties. Our loyalties to God. People of God will live as God commands. You are a child of God. I'm a child of God. We live as God commands us. Instructed us. So when we live hopeful, when we live hopeful lives in a world filled with despair and hopelessness, we will be noticed. Everybody there wondering about this, that, and that, and frantic and excited and anxious about this and that, and we cool and calm. What's the matter with you? How come you're so cool? Because I have a hope, brother. I have a hope. You're sounding hopelessly anxious, or anxiously hopeless. But I have a hope. And because of this hope, I'm not anxious for anything. I'm not careful for anything. But in everything through prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, I made my request known to God, and the peace of God have me cool. Hello. Welcome to the Christian life. Take it or leave it. Hard times are coming. You better know Jesus. I say, you better know Jesus. Look what 1 Peter 3:15 says. When we live hopeful lives in a world filled with despair and hopelessness, we will be noticed by people to the point where they come and say, Peter says in 3:15, he said, but sanctify the Lord thy God in your heart and be ready to give, always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the what? Hope that is in you with what? Meekness and fear. So we will be noticed, or we may even be confronted. But either case, we must be prepared to point to Jesus and what he has done for us. Amen? So I'll leave you with this. Although, you know, somebody said, well, you know, is good behavior necessary if you're a Christian? Isn't faith enough? I have faith in God, so I don't have to worry about anything else. Let me show you something. Faith alone, nada, will get you nowhere. Read your Bible. Although our good behavior can't save us, our behavior proves whether our faith is genuine. Watch this. Faith by itself isn't enough. Unless it produces good behavior and deeds, it is dead and useless. So James tells us, 2:17, if he said, even so, faith, if it had not worked, is dead being alone. So if our sinful behavior doesn't change because of our faith, is our confession of faith really genuine? If our sinful behavior doesn't change because of our faith, is our confession of faith really genuine? I'm asking a question. But let me give you the answer. The fact is this. If I have a confession of faith, I will have a changed life that goes with it. So if you say you have faith and not a changed life, your faith is dead. So faith is synonymous with a changed life. Faith alone, not enough. Okay, I hope you understand what I'm saying. So have we asked God to forgive our sins into our lives and transform us from the inside out? Watch this. Faith without good deeds is powerless. It has no hands, no feet to get anything done. So it's powerless. Right? Good deeds without faith is like hands and feet with no brain to give their work any ultimate purpose. So you need both. Faith and good deeds. If you have the hands, you got to have the brain. You have the brain and no hands, no good. So together, God's truth and our consecrated hands and feet are a dynamic combination that can change the world for Jesus Christ. And that's my message for you tonight. Amen? And here's a promise that God has given to you and me. As Jesus was speaking to a woman, I want you to turn to the scripture and I want to show you something probably you never see. Watch this. And this is going to change your life Sunday morning. When you come to church, this scripture is going to change your life. Watch this. Ready for it? How many of you want this revelation? Okay. As Jesus was speaking, turn to Luke chapter 11. Luke chapter 11, verse 27 and 28. As Jesus was speaking, a woman in the crowd shouted, God bless your mother. God bless the womb from which you came. God bless the breast that nursed you. Do you know what Jesus replied to her? Look at it here in Luke chapter 11, verse 27. And it came to pass, as he, Jesus, was speaking these things, a certain woman of the company lifted up her voice and said unto him, blessed is the womb that bare thee and the paps which thou hast sucked. But he said, Yea, rather, blessed are they that hear the word of God and keep it. So here she says, Jesus, you're blessed. God bless your mother. God bless you. God bless the womb which you came. God bless the breast that fed you. So he turned to her and said, woman, yeah, that is good. And the reply was, you'll be more blessed if you would hear God's word and keep it and practice it. So watch that, what that means. Watch this. When it comes Sunday morning, Lord, I praise you. I bless you, Lord. Bless the Lord of my soul and all that's within me. God said, all that is really good. But you'd be more blessed if you hear my words. Walk out here and do it. Let's stand. So I hope you walk out here. You heard something to walk out here tonight. And go out there and do it. How many receive that word tonight? You receive that teaching tonight? Give the Lord a hand of praise. Come on. Thank you, Lord. Oh, Lord, we give you praise. We give you thanks. We give you thanks. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, we give you praise. Lift your voice and give the Lord thanks tonight. You know, God is teaching us. God is preparing us. God has a plan for us. Listen. Good behavior and godly living, your Christian conduct is what God wants you to focus on, your conduct in this ungodly world. Remember, your attitude communicates clearer than your words. And God expects of us to have good attitude, godly behavior in this ungodly world. God has a plan for the ungodly. He has a plan for the righteous. If the righteous clearly be saved, where shall the ungodly and sinners appear? My friends, lift your hands right now and be thankful that you have the opportunity to be wiser tonight, to receive God's word. You that are listening today, I pray that God will touch you and transform your life, that you will never be conformed to this ungodly world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you will know what is the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God, and you will surrender your will to his will and serve him and worship him. Hallelujah. We praise you, Father. Oh, we worship you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Go ahead, lift your voices and worship him. Hallelujah. Jesus, we give you praise. Lord, help us to walk in obedience tonight. Help us to be all that we can be, Lord. Lord, I give you praise. Help us to learn something tonight, Lord. I pray that that word will rest in your heart tonight. That this teaching, Lord, will edify them. They'll remember what they heard in this assembly, around the world, in every nation, in every home. Let the light of Christ shine. Let our attitude be godly. Help us to conduct ourselves and be an example to one another, to understand relationship. Oh God, to put off and put on, to replace all the personal desires and acknowledge you and replace them with the leading of the Holy Spirit. Create in me a clean heart, O Lord, and renew the right spirit within me, yeah, Lord. Create in me a clean heart. Let it be a prayer tonight. Prepare us, Lord, for your coming. Prepare us to be a light to the world. Prepare us, Lord, to evangelize, to share, to let men know that you live in us. There's a changed life. I'm a changed man. We are a changed people. Prepare us, Lord God.
Holy Spirit from me, Lord, restore unto me
the joy of thy salvation. And renew the right spirit within me. Everybody, come on to the altar. We'll dismiss right here. Just come for a minute.
Create in me a clean heart.
Come gather in the center right here. We're going to pray. Worship you, Lord.
And renew a right spirit within me.
Surrender everything to Him.
Create in me a clean heart, oh Lord.
Help us now to live godly lives, Lord.
And renew a right
spirit. God, good behavior, Lord.
Within me.
Good behavior and godly life. Help us tonight, Lord.
Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord.
Take not, Lord.
Take not thy Holy Spirit from me.
Let's live a better Christian life, Lord. Help us to grow, to be nurtured, Lord. Be strengthened in the inner man.
Be
all that we can be, O God. We surrender, we surrender all
weakness.
We surrender our lives to you, Lord. God, we choose not to sin presumptuously, Lord. Forgive us our mistakes. Forgive us, oh God, for everything that we have done to displease you, Lord. We just want to live a godly life.
Take not thy Holy
Spirit. We just want to have godly behavior, good behavior. And live a godly life in your presence. Touch your people, Lord. Touch us all. Bless us, renew us tonight, refresh us. And refresh you tonight. And restore your mind. Strengthen you. Clean you up. The Spirit of God is right here to touch you, to anoint you, to bless you. He'll give you the desires of your heart. God can read the pages of your heart. And the passion in you right now, He understands. Release your anointing, God. Break every yoke. Destroy it, Lord. Clean up, Lord, everything, Lord, that is not satisfying or pleasing to you. Cleanse us, Lord, thoroughly tonight.
Oh, we bless you, Lord.
Help us, the Lord, conduct ourselves to live to please you. Good behavior, godly lives. All you ask of us, Lord. All you ask of us tonight. Jesus, we thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Come, Pastor Ted, lead us in prayer, will you? Take the microphone and lead us in prayer. Pray for all of us tonight. Those watching, everyone, wherever you may be tonight, just surrender your life. Ask God to really help you to be your best. Yes, you can. God has placed the resources in you. He has a great expectation of you. He knows exactly what you're capable of. Give Him your best tonight. Good behavior and godly living. Let's pray tonight. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, we give you praise. Lord, we give you praise. God, we give you praise this evening. Lord, we say thank you, O God, for your word, O God, that went forth. Lord, Father God, such a sobering word this evening, Lord Jesus. Lord, Father God, even now as we stand at this altar, God, this evening, Lord, Father God, as we meditate upon a word that was shed this evening, Lord God, this evening we ask you to search our hearts, O God. Lord God, they that are looking on, O God, Father, even at this point in time, O God, I pray, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, that, O God, this evening they will submit. We all will submit to your word this evening, O God. We will submit to the authority of your word this evening, Lord Jesus. Lord, Father God, we ask you to search us this evening. Search us this evening, O God. Search our hearts this evening, O God. And Father God, see if there be any wicked way this evening, O God. Any sinful way in us this evening, O God. And we ask you to take it out. Take it out this evening. Lord God, we ask you to forgive us, oh God, this evening, oh God, as we forgive all those who have trespassed against us, oh God. Lord, we ask you to forgive us this evening.
Oh,
we ask you to take your coals this evening, oh God, and cleanse our lips this evening, oh God. Hallelujah. Lord God, as we Meditate upon your word, oh God. We pray going forward, oh God, that our feet, oh God, will be prepared with the preparation of your gospel this evening, oh God. Your word we will hide in our hearts, that we will not sin against thee, oh God. Lord God, all we like as sheep have gone astray this evening, oh God. Lord, we have gone astray, oh God. Like we have gone do our own thing, oh God. We have gone our own way this evening, but tonight, oh God, we say we are sorry, God. Lord, we say forgive us this evening, oh God. Lord God, we humble ourselves and we turn from our wicked ways this evening, oh God. We call it as it is this evening, oh God.
My God.
And Lord, we depend on you this evening. We ask you, oh God, to forgive us, oh God. And give us the strength, oh God, to run this race that is set before us, oh God. That we'll run and not be weary, oh God. We'll walk and not faint, oh God. We'll mount up with wings as an eagle this evening, oh God. That our light will so shine that men will see our good works and glorify you which is in heaven,
Lord,
oh God.
Yes, Lord.
Help us to love one another, oh God. Help us to love one another, oh God. Help us to walk, oh God, in your spirit of truth this evening, oh God. To walk in your bond of peace this evening, oh God. To look to you this evening, oh God.
Yes.
With expectation, oh God. Not denying the faith, oh God.
My God.
Lord, cover us this evening in your blood.
In your blood.
Protect us, oh God, Jesus.
Lord,
help us to be that light, oh God.
Yes, God.
Help us to be that salt this evening, oh God.
Wherever
we go, in our jobs, in our schools, oh God, in our homes, in our neighborhood, oh God, even in your ministry, oh God, to one another, oh God, let your love encompass us this evening, Jesus. And Lord, we say, not our will, God, but thy will be done. In Jesus' name.
Jesus.
Amen.
Embrace the person next to you and tell them you love them tonight. Jesus. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you. Be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace now and forevermore. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Just remind of the announcement. Go ahead and remind them.